Electric cars have earned a bad reputation for being terrible in the winter. When the temperatures drop, they can lose upwards of 30% of their range, and all the weight from all those batteries means they tend to be pretty poor to drive in the snow, too. Teslas in particular have earned a bad rep. California's most famous electric car startup is perceived as building California cars, that is to say, machines that need to pack an extra sweater at the first hint of a morning chill. And so a lot of people in more extreme latitudes feel like they need to buy a car like this, a big old gas-guzzling 4x4. But we've come north to show you that there might be another way. Welcome to Tesla's Alaska Proving Grounds, where we're going to give you an exclusive look at some of the tests the Tesla engineers put their production car through to make sure they're ready for the winter. Cars like the Model 3, like this dual motor here, the Model S, like this P100D, and of course, the Model X, with its big silly doors. We'll start with the big guy. Well, you better get rolling. We only have 4 hours of daylight.
Tesla's testing facility is located out in the middle of the state, a solid 2 hours from Fairbanks, headed in the general direction of, well, nothing much in particular. This area is also where the military performs cold weather testing of much of its hardware, and the conditions this time of year are no joke. Tesla engineers have at their disposal a massive test loop complete with numerous stretches of ice, a giant slippery skid pad, groomed snowfields, handling courses, and some steeper stuff too.
Our first test of the day is a hill, and that may not sound like much, but this is a very steep hill, 30 degrees, which is about as steep as you're ever going to find in the real world. But to make it more difficult, we've got a strip of ice down the middle, and I'm going to try to drive with the car with one set of wheels on the ice and the other set of wheels off the ice. And finally, we've turned off all the software assists in the Model X here to see just what this car does in its raw state, a state that you can only get to with a developer who plugs a laptop into a port right there. So here we go. Going to get a bit of a running start to give the car more of a chance. I've got my foot to the floor. I can hear the tires spinning. We're going nowhere. In fact, we're going backwards. Okay. Now that didn't work. And the reason it didn't work, because the Model X, like a lot of cars, has what's called an open differential. And I could spend an hour explaining what that means, but suffice to say, a differential transfers power from the left side of the car to the right side of the car. And in normal conditions, they work really well. However, in a low grip situation like this, an open differential actually would just spin up the wheel that's sitting on the ice. And that's exactly what just happened. To defeat that, we've got to turn the software back on. All right, we're in the same Model X with the same hill with the same ice in front of us. The only difference is we've turned on all the software assistance systems. Now we're going to see what happens. And it goes pretty much right on up. Now, again, nothing's changed in the hardware. We have the same open differentials front and rear connected to those electric motors. So why was that so easy? Well, now the software is using braking to basically slow down the wheel that's spinning, transferring power over to the wheel with grip, allowing us to get up the hill. That made that a whole lot easier than it was before.
This trick of using brakes to overcome the primary disadvantage of open differentials is hardly novel to Tesla. Audi and plenty of others have been doing it forever, but it's always impressive to see just how effective it can be, and how hopeless open differentials are on the ice when left to their own devices.
All right, we've shifted over to the Model S for our next test because we're going to have to go a little bit quicker this time. Now we're going to do an emergency lane change on the snow. We've again turned everything off on the car. All the nannies, all the safety systems have been killed in developer mode. Okay, we're entering onto the snow now. And I'm going about 65, and oh no, a moose! Oh. Okay, well, I caught it, but it was... Okay, I didn't catch it. Shoot, I thought I caught it.
What happened there is what you might call a tank slapper. The quick steering one way upset the car so much that when I countered and caught the slide, the weight transfer sent it swinging back in the other direction. That then results in a frantic bit of shuffling left and right to try to keep the car under control. We ran this test multiple times and I did indeed catch it a couple times, but it's the kind of event that would likely send your average Model S driver spiraling into the wilderness. Thankfully, your average Model S driver will never experience this. The stability control system on the Model S, which cannot normally be turned off, will actively cut power and apply brakes to individual wheels, keeping everything in line.
Okay, we've reset the car. We've got everything turned back on. We're going to try that one more time. Now, I can already feel the traction control throttling back the power as I enter the snow here, but we're going to still get up to 65 just like before. And watch out for that moose. And wow, well, that was kind of boring, but ultimately, if you were on a highway covered in snow and a moose jumped out in front of you and threatened to bite your sister, you'd kind of want the situation to be a little bit boring and ultimately nice and safe and controlled. But if you want to have a little bit more fun, maybe you want things to feel a little bit less in control. And for that, we got to change cars one more time. We're in a Model 3 Performance now, and we're on what is basically a snow and ice circle, like a big old skid pad with a lot of freshly groomed snow, some corduroy that I'm gonna go out and make a big mess on. And we're gonna start in normal mode with all the traction and safety controls and everything else left on, because I was told by the Tesla engineers that the car should actually be a lot more fun to drive than the Model S or the Model X, even with everything on. And sure enough, it does allow the tail to come out. But as soon as it gets too far out, maybe something like 15 or 20 degrees, I can definitely feel at that point the power starts to shift, the brakes come on. It's basically braking the outside wheels to try to bring the car around, to bring the nose around, and to enable things to stay in control. So even if I'm doing something stupid, like trying to really turn the wheel over, the car won't spin. It just slows down, cuts my power, and keeps me safe. But you can definitely still have a good time. And that's very different than the Model S, which pretty much immediately just cut all the power and made sure that you stayed nice and in line. But the beauty of the Model 3 Performance is that you don't need an engineer with a laptop to have a little bit more fun. All we need to do, go into the car settings, tap the little button that says track mode, and now, and I can already feel that I've got a lot more power at my disposal. Before, it would cut the power very early to keep any wheel spin from going on, but now I can go much more quickly and much, much, much more sideways. Now, when I get the car way out of line here, I can still feel that the systems are kicking in to help me keep the car in control, but there's a big, big envelope for me to play within so that I can still have the time to do what I know I need to do to bring the car back into control, and it's only when things go really sideways that I get a little bit of help. So if the car starts to understeer, for example, I can lift off the throttle a little bit, get a little more weight on the nose, and the car comes right around. And of course, give it a lot of counter-steer here to keep the tail in line too. This is really good fun, but I still have that safety blanket to keep me safe should I do something really stupid. And now we are on what the engineers here call the quarry. It's basically a tight handling course with a lot of dips and crests and ups and downs and tight turns, which is a really good test for the active torque vectoring in the Model 3 with track mode on. The car can really quickly shift torque from front to rear and basically give you all the response you want up front or out back to give you everything you need to do. Do a nice little pendulum turn like that. It's got more responsiveness than any other all-wheel drive car on the road, really, because there's no differential that you need to worry about clutch plates or a viscous center diff or anything like that that needs to adjust. Basically, they can adjust as much power to the front or to the rear as they want pretty much instantaneously. And as a bit of a differential nerd as I am, the potential here makes me pretty excited for something like ice racing, where you really need a lot of quick power shifts to be able to get the car to do what you want it to do when you want it to do it. And this is such good fun, I cannot begin to tell you. Now granted, this isn't the kind of thing that your average Model 3 owner is going to do, but sure is good to know that you can. And again, I can still feel the car doing some work to help me. It's still doing some braking across the axles to help the car pivot. And it's still doing some work to help, again, make sure that I'm keeping in control and not getting too far out of line. But again, it's letting me do what I want to do, and the car is doing what I want it to do. And that is beautiful. To be totally honest, I had no idea what to expect coming up here. I didn't even know this place existed until a couple of weeks ago. But at the end of the day, I am incredibly impressed. If you've read my coverage of the Model 3, you know I haven't always been this car's biggest fan. But to be able to do a Scandinavian flick like that with the traction control on, that's pretty special stuff. Yeah, I wish I could turn everything off without having to rely on an engineer with a laptop. And yes, if you're driving these cars in the cold, you will lose some range. But if you're a Tesla owner and you put your car up for the winter, you're making a terrible mistake. Now, if you'll excuse me, I still got a couple hours of sunlight left, and I got a big snowfield with my name on it.